while back, and I got almost here, got a text message saying we don't have any power, and we're not gonna be able to meet this morning. There's been a bad storm, if I remember correctly, and I was out to Weston, I guess. West Union, I guess. And fortunately, I had a signal, got a text before I got over here, but it's good to be with you this morning. I'm Steve Snider. Been in this area for a long time, been preaching for about 45 years, most of it in Marion County, West Virginia. A town called Berryville for 35 of those 45 years. And then prior to last year, I preached a little town called Daybrook, West Virginia, over in Mon County. Taught at the West Virginia School of Preaching for many years. Traffic. They said everybody wanted to be the first to go when it's their turn. And if you can imagine the other side of the street being the same way, you can imagine the chaos when traffic finally starts moving. This is not a traffic jam, this is just traffic. This is a typical traffic scene in a major city. And I'm not exaggerating, sometimes it would be about as fast to walk as it would to try to get through some of these cities that have millions and millions of people in them. This is our team, our American team. We have 5 full-time Americans working with the team. We did something back in February, March, that had not been done in 40 years. This team actually began back in 1979 with a man by the name of Ron Clayton. I don't know if you've ever heard that name, but Ron died unexpectedly in the spring of 2020. And that's kind of how I got on board full time. I went to his funeral in Alabama. And by the way, this work was overseen by the Shiloh Church of Christ in Hazel Green, Alabama. But I went to his funeral, and the other full-time team members approached me and said, listen, with Ron's passing, there's going to be a huge void in this work. You know the work. You know how to fundraise. We need you on this team full-time. So I finally made the decision to go on board full-time. But we don't want all of us to be there at the same time. Our goal is for one of us to be there most of the time. And so between the 5 of us, we're going to cover 10 to 11 months a year where one of us will be in India kind of overseeing the work there. But because Ron had passed, and because nobody had been there in 2 years due to COVID and Indian regulations and restrictions, we made the decision to take the whole team together. And we met with 100 of our India team leaders to just talk about the future of the work. There was a lot of uncertainty, a lot of fear. With the passing of Ron Clayton, the work would stop. And so we made the decision for all of us to go at the same time. To my left is Ben Reniger, then myself, Kyle Clayton, who is Ron Clayton's son and married a girl from India. So they have a great knowledge of India customs, cultures, laws, and things of that nature. That's his mother standing next to him, Karen Clayton, Ron's wife. Next to her is Robert Hall, who is now the new director of this team. And next to him is Joe Evans and his wife, Diane. And they came on board about the same time as I did. So this is our full-time American team. We met with 100 of our key India team leaders. We have thousands of preachers that work with us in India. These are our team leaders who will all have anywhere from 20 to 200 preachers working with them. So we had a place kind of in a remote area where we wouldn't draw too much unnecessary attention, and we brought all 100 of them there to meet with them for a couple of days. We took turns speaking during the day, and then we would break up into small groups of 20 and let them talk to us about the work, what their concerns were, what they felt we could do to improve the work. And it was just a great 2 days, and they asked us to please not wait 4 years before we could begin. This is Brother Robert Hall simply speaking to our team leaders. And again, we were just telling them what the expectations were, some changes that were being made with the new team, and again, assuring them that the work was going to continue. We found an English book, a ready reference book, where it has just Bible topics, a bunch of passages that relate to those topics. We had it translated, I believe, into Telugu, printed about 3,000 copies at an incredibly decent price. Because we had our team leaders here, we gave all of them a copy, and then gave them 10, 15, 20 copies to take back to their preacher. So we distributed a bunch of them right here on this one occasion, but they love this tool. It's really helpful to them in India. One of the customs in India is that if somebody in your family dies on the first year anniversary of their death, they always have some kind of a memorial. Not just for important people, that's just kind of an Indian custom. Well, while we were there, the 1 year anniversary of Brother Ron Clayton came up. And the Indians were pretty adamant because he'd been involved in wars in 1979. And they were pretty adamant that we have a memorial in his honor. Well, we knew that this was going to be big, so we rented this hall. We didn't decorate it, we just rented it. That's what it looked like when we got there. But look at this turnout. They estimated over 800 people turned out for this memorial service. Not just Christians, not just preachers. There were Muslims there, there were shop owners there that knew Ron because of how many years he'd spent in India. And so it was quite a turnout. We had a nice memorial in Ron's memory. Even if you're speaking to people in India in English, you have to be very careful how and what you say. We had several pictures of Ron up on kind of a stage And when the memorial was winding down, his son got up and said to the audience, if you would like to take a picture of Dad, feel free to do so. He meant take their phone and take a picture of the picture. You know what they did? They took the pictures. But he said, if you'd like to take a picture of Dad, you can. And so they did. We got most of them back because they were special pictures. When I left, they still had one they hadn't found yet, but they took the pictures. So even when you're speaking English, you have to be very, very careful what you say. I was walking into a village years ago, and I saw this really nice bush with these really pretty berries on it. So I picked a few up, and I said to my translator, are these edible? Yes. So I'm getting ready to eat them. He said, brother, don't eat those. Those are poison. Will kill you. Well, he didn't know what edible meant. So you have to be careful exactly what you say, even if you're speaking English, because communication is a problem sometimes. A lot of people in India are very poor. India has some of the richest people in the world, but you also find some of the poorest people in the world as well. This is just a village scene several years ago, but nothing's changed much when you get back to these villages. Look at this statistic. 325 million live on $650 a year. This would be a family of four. Another 300 million live on $1,500 or less a year, a family of four. You put those two together, that's half the population of India. Lives on $1,500 a year or less for a family of four. That's not a lot of money. We do a lot of work, again, in the villages, among some of the poor people, and it deeply touches them just that we would even come into their village. Because a lot of them are viewed as social outcasts, and people that just that have anything don't come there. And so they're kind of amazed that we would even come to their village, let alone spend time with them and try to teach them about Christ. But despite their poverty, they're extremely hospitable. And it's extremely important to them. Now those are little cups of coffee. I'm not a coffee drinker, but I drink that because it's offered. Now, they don't ask you how you like it. It comes with milk and sugar. But if we have a lot of meetings in people's homes, and they almost always feel obligated, not because we want them to, but because they feel that sense of hospitality, they almost always want to serve some kind of refreshments. Normally it's those little cups of coffee and what they call biscuits or cookies. But also, quite often, a whole lot more people will show up than they expect. They may be counting 15, 20 people, and 50 may show up, and they hear the word of the Bible study in this person's home. And just like in John chapter 2, the wedding feast in Cana, where they ran out of wine, a lot of times they won't have enough refreshments. And so I'll see them huddled up somewhere, and I'll say, what's the problem? Brother, we don't have near enough refreshments for everybody here. And so I always ask, is there a store close by? Yes. Well, go get what you need and I'll pay for it. And we're normally talking $5, $10, but they don't have $5. They probably have already spent money they couldn't afford to spend to be hospitable. I've learned to really like Indian food, but even before I learned to like it, I did my best to always eat. Because if you don't, they don't get mad at you. They feel ashamed that they haven't served you something that was appropriate. I went into an Indian home, and they were really excited. It was on a Sunday morning after services. They said, we got a special treat for you. They said, we know you eat chicken almost all the time. Well, today we're having fish. Well, I don't eat fish in India, unless it's at a five-star hotel or five-star restaurant. You want to get sick in a hurry, eat seafood in India. And I said, and then they brought it out. It was in a big pot, red gravy, the head. Everything was floating around in. Had I eaten fish, I'm not sure I could have eaten that. But I said, I'm sorry, I don't eat fish in India, but you've got bread, you've got rice, I've got plenty, don't worry about it. I left, preached in that area again Sunday night, and my translator said, brother, you've got another meal appointment tonight. It was back at that same house, and they'd served me chicken. You see, they felt like they'd not been proper hosts when they served me fish in the morning. So now they spent twice on money they probably couldn't afford to spend the first time. But that's important for them to be hospitable. Almost always, when they go to any kind of extraordinary measure, I almost always leave some money. I don't tell them it's for the meal. I just tell them, here's something for your family. I appreciate your kindness. I appreciate your work. Here's something for your family. Use it any way you see fit. And hopefully it'll reestablish their food allowance Because I had Indian translators tell me that what they served us was probably a month of their food allowance to feed us. So it's very important to them. They always greet you most of the time with a garland. But look at this next one. I've been to India over 20 times. I've never in my life seen a garland that big. That's the biggest. They didn't even put it around my neck. I don't know what it weighed. They just held it there. But you like this next picture. It shows you how important a person I really am. I'm really not important. I'm just kidding you. I'm really not important, and I don't think that I'm important. They have not seen me in 9 years. I've not been to India in 9 years, and they were just thrilled that I came. And so there's three different kinds of greetings. Sometimes they'll greet you with a hat. Sometimes they wrap a shawl around you, and they almost always greet you with a garland. Well, they had all three of those for me on this occasion. So I was a very welcome guest. It's extremely touching the way the Indian brethren respond to us. My wife and I lost a son back in 2013. That was the last year I'd gone until this year. And my son was a preacher and had made mission trips with me to India, so that they knew my son. And again, I'd not been there since my son had died. And two or three times on the trip back in February, a preacher would see me and he'd come running to me crying. And he would say, "Well, I'm so sorry about Aaron. And brother, we didn't think we'd ever see you again." He said, "We've been texting you for 9 years and you kept saying you didn't know you'd ever be able to come back to India." It's a warm welcome everywhere you go, and it's just touching to deal with the Indian brethren. They're wonderful people. Travel between major cities, not out in the remote areas where we go, but travel between major cities has greatly improved to the point that trips that used to take us 8 to 10 to 12 hours, we now do in 5 or 6 because they've got almost an interstate system. Because of that, these little travel classes have opened up, and this is really nice because we can stop and get something to drink or get a meal in a pretty decent setting. So it makes our travel a little nicer, but I want you to look at this sign for the restroom. Men to the left because women are always right. Now, I'll leave that up to you all to work out after I leave, but that's what the sign says. Men to the left because women are always right. This is a pretty typical Indian meal. Rice and chicken with a little very hot, spicy curry sauce. When you travel in India, you won't see this around West Virginia much, but you have to deal with this. This is the main highway, and this guy's driving sheep and goats probably to another pasture, maybe to water, maybe back home, but you just have to stop and wait until they clear. Here comes a guy with a bunch of camels. Nothing special. It's in the circus, not a movie. He's just going down the road with his camels, and again, you just got to kind of get out of the way. Here's a guy riding his elephant down the street. Again, these are sights that you won't see around here very often, but we see them quite often in India. I missed the picture I wanted here. That's a sacred animal in India. It's a Brahma bull, but it's sacred. Cows are sacred in India. Right before I snapped the picture, he had his nose right against that bus and would not move. You can't hit him, you can't slap him, you can't do anything. That's a sacred animal. And so they're blowing the horn, people are screaming at him. He won't move. He's got traffic stopped. He's got traffic backed up. And he's there. And right when I got ready to snap the picture, he moved and started meandering down the street, and traffic started moving again. But you'll come out of a restaurant and there'll be animals like that begging like a dog. You'll see them everywhere. And I've gone into Hindu temples just to tour, and I have to put coverings over my shoes, put something on my head. That animal can walk through there and do whatever it wants because it's a sacred animal. I tell people this is what we look like at the end of the day. This actually is right outside my hotel room where I was staying. I looked out my window and there were these monkeys on the wall. I got some fruit and vegetables and they were more than happy to take them. You gotta be careful. They get pretty aggressive and not biting on purpose, but they'll bite you when they're trying to take it from you. This is a huge picture frame of preacher's home talking about the one true church. Indian preachers are absolutely unashamed of the gospel. They're unashamed of the church. They're unashamed of God's plan of salvation. And you go into an Indian preacher's home and you're not a Christian, odds are before you leave, he's going to start talking to you about Jesus Christ. They're very unashamed and they're very evangelistic. Here's what we're up against. denominationalism. Every major denomination in America has work in India. And so just as we do it here, we deal with it in India as well. This is a large denomination in an area called Beaver. I'd spoken in a person's home during the week, and one of the leaders of this religious denomination was in the class I was teaching. And I talked about Paul's plea to the Corinthians from 1 Corinthians 1, a plea for unity, a plea for the name of Christ, and a plea for baptism. And he heard that lesson. And when I got through, he came to me and said, "Would you speak at the denomination that I'm one of the leaders in Sunday?" I said, "Sure. What am I allowed to speak?" And he said, "I want you to speak the same lesson we taught here tonight." So I went, congregation 300, 350 people. The man in the white robes is not me. I'm standing next to him in an orange outfit that is an Indian outfit. But I had to use their translator. They let me use mine. I had to use theirs. But my translator was sitting right in front of me. And I said, "If he doesn't say exactly what I say, you let me know and I'll stop this and we'll either fix it or it'll be over." But he said exactly what I said. And I preached that same lesson, the need for unity, the need for baptism, the need for the name of Christ, and they listened very respectfully. One of the things that one of our team members does is he conducts denominational preacher seminars. When he's in India, he'll set these up in several locations, and he'll get anywhere from 25 to 50 or 60 denominational preachers to come, and he'll have several lessons just talking about New Testament Christianity. I spoke at this one. I was the last speaker on this occasion because several people will normally teach and speak. When I got through, one of the denominational preachers came to me and said, "You must never do this again." Well, I thought I'd offended him. And I said, "Sir, would you mind telling me why I must never do this again?" He said, "Because it's not long enough. We've only been here 2 days. This is important. This should go on for at least a week as we talk about these things." That's how open they are to the concept of New Testament Christianity. I spoke in a Pentecostal church. We get a lot of invitations to speak in denominational churches. One Sunday, a few years ago, I had 6 speaking appointments on a Sunday. My first 5 were denominations. After about the 4th one, I said to my translator, "Brother, am I going to meet with the Lord's people anytime today?" I said, "It's the Lord's day. I need to commune. I need to worship." "Yes, brother, your last one. 10:30 at night. 10:30 at night, I was meeting with the church of our Lord. But the first 5 were denominations. But I spoke at the Pentecostal church from Acts 8, the conversion of Simon the sorcerer. And I pointed out how he was converted through the preaching of the gospel and those kind of things, baptizing in Christ. But then I pointed out that after they were converted, Peter and John had to come down from Jerusalem to lay hands on them so they could have the miraculous gift of the Holy Spirit. And I reminded them, Philip was there performing miracles. Why didn't Philip pass the gifts on? Because he couldn't. Only through the laying on of the apostles' hands could the miraculous gifts be passed on. I said, now that being true, and that's what the text says, by the way, Simon the sorcerer saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, these gifts were given. If that's true, what happened when the last apostle died? The gifts have to die as well. They can't be passed on any longer. When I got through, the Pentecostal preacher got up and said, "We've heard an important lesson here tonight, and we need to study this carefully because based on what the Word of God says, it appears we're claiming power that we don't really have." I thought, that's honest. That's honest. A lot of times when I speak in denominational churches, I speak from John 17, Jesus' prayer for unity. And I talk about the fact that Jesus, knowing he's going to the cross, is in prayer to his Father. And what's on his mind? One of the things on his mind is that we would be united. And I point out to him very kindly, very plainly, we're not united. You know, we're the same name. We don't even teach the same plan of salvation. Yes. Okay. Okay, got perfect. We don't teach the same plan of salvation. We're not one. And then I talk about how we can be one by getting back to the body. Well, I can't tell you how many denominational preachers have gotten up and said, Jesus is praying for unity, and we're not one. And we need to fix that. We need to start knowing what the Bible says. You convert a denominational preacher, and we have converted thousands of them this year. Most of them preach for 2 or 3 churches. After you convert a denominational preacher, you're going to start hearing of 10, 20, 30, hundreds of other people being baptized, and they go back and start teaching the truth to their churches. A lot of times we get church buildings as well. Idol worship is a big thing in India. Some of the Indian idols. These are actually children paying homage to Ganesh, the elephant god. This was a little temple. We stopped, my trainer said, I want you to look inside, there's a statue. He said, what's that remind you of? I said, the Virgin Mary is what it reminds me of. That's exactly right. I said, so Roman Catholics built this little temple. He said, no, Hindu. They heard of Mary, just add her to the list of God. That's what we have to deal with. You have to be careful in dealing with Hindus. You have to make it clear to them. You're not giving him another God. You're talking about the one true God. If they want to follow Christ, they've got to give up. And they will. Once you talk them, they'll give up the Hindu God. And some of them might have to ask you to change their name because their name is a reflection of some other God. I had a man come to me and said, told me when he became a Christian, he said, and I changed my name. And I said, tell me your name. I'll take your picture. He stood up real proud and said, my name is Abraham Lincoln. I don't know who gave him that name. I don't know where I heard of Abraham Lincoln. But that was a new name. We had preacher training classes. We've estimated, these were shut down for COVID for a while. We have preacher schools. We estimate over 20,000 students weekly are in some kind of training in India. We have sometimes just special classes while we're there. So this is a group of about 100 preachers who came just so we can teach during the day and help them grow in the knowledge of Christ. There they were writing down notes from my sermon, my lesson, so that they could take notes. The ladies like to come, not to be preachers, but just to learn in the special classes. I'm not a preacher, but in the special classes, the ladies will come so they can learn more about the Bible. This is how you take attendance. People will ask. Because anytime you go into a place of worship or at any home, you take the shoes off. So you have to, you always see all these shoes outside, and they always find their own in some interesting way. We do a lot of gospel meetings. In India, a gospel meeting is anytime you study with an unbeliever. Maybe one-on-one, maybe in somebody's home. It's not a gospel meeting like we're accustomed to here. The amazing thing about Indians is any occasion to bring people together becomes a gospel meeting. A child's birthday party, you have a gospel meeting before the party, and all the adults there will listen to the gospel. I've spoken at birthday parties, I've spoken at funerals, I've spoken at weddings. Can you imagine America? I went to a wedding for 400 people. I got there, a preacher said, it's not going to start for 45 minutes. Why don't you preach until it's time for the wedding to start? Nobody got mad. Nobody got up and left. Just preach the gospel. Any occasion to bring people together, they have a Bible study. These are just pictures of gospel meetings. We estimate over 2 million people are taught every year by this team. Not Americans only, but Americans and Indians. We average about 3 baptisms per meeting. Not every meeting has baptisms. Some meetings have a lot more. But we average about 2 to 3 baptisms per meeting. We don't have mass conversions very often, but we hold mass meetings. If I go into an area and have preacher classes for several days and 50 preachers show up, I send all 50 of them out of 19 Bible studies. And so we have a lot of Bible studies going on. This is me speaking at a gospel meeting. Congregation has grown tremendously since I was there last. This is a large congregation, about 300 people, our brethren. I just want you to see these. Look at the guys down at the bottom taking notes. Got a pen in their hand taking notes. These girls got their Bibles open, got notes. These folks are simply saying, I want to become a Christian. They sing an invitation song. I speak. My translator gives a little exhortation. They'll ask anybody want to become a New Testament Christian. They simply raise their hands. We take their names and make arrangements at that time. This guy was sitting out in the street. Wasn't even inside. When they said, anybody want to become a Christian, he raised his hand. He was sitting out the street listening. This man I hired in his car for 4 days. All my meetings were outside. The first night he slept in the car. Second night he was standing by the car and took that picture. Third night he was at the back of the meeting. Fourth night he was up front. Right after I left, they baptized him in the Christ. You never know when these folks are listening. This is the largest meeting I've ever held in India, outdoors. They estimate between 2,000 and 2,500 people were at this meeting. We baptized 75 when the meeting was over. They have to give us reports where they spoke, how many baptisms there were. Here's one report. They had 40 Bible studies, 65 people baptized, no new congregation, no denominational preachers converted. When we send them out, at night, they're given 500 rupees, that's $7. $7. That covers their meal and their transportation. Here's a lady being baptized after a Sunday morning where I preached. Had several ladies being baptized here. Notice in the background, those are water buffalo. This is a canal. She's being baptized, and the water buffalo are right behind her. New sisters in Christ. We buy a lot of Bibles in several different languages. We buy bicycles. The Indians call them gospel chariots. They don't have cars, they don't have motorcycles, most of them. They can ride their bicycles to a preaching and teaching class. do a lot of benevolence. We're buying some children, some clothes. Here we're just passing out the ball rooms, toothbrushes. These children, on this trip, all of these children lost both parents due to COVID. The lady is a school teacher, her husband, one of our team leaders. They took all of them into their home. We're helping them until they can find permanent residence for them. This lady had leprosy. I gave her money to help with medicine. This lady lost her husband due to appendicitis. Now she's a widow with three children. Sometimes we buy them animals so they can raise them, breed them, and have a steady income without us. The retention rate, 70 to 85%, because they love the Bible. They love the Word of God. People like you have made a difference. Last slide. This man was at a meeting out in the village, 12, 15 people there. I said, would anybody like to become a Christian? Or my translator did. He raised his hand with his other hand and took his hanky out and began to cry. After my translator, I said, what's the problem? He said, brother, we've been teaching here for several weeks. He's ready to obey the gospel. His wife died 2 weeks ago. Now, brother, not only did he understand what he was about to do, he understood the consequences of what his wife had not done. And he had broken heart. I was broken heart, but I was too obedient. We can't save everybody, but we can save a lot of them. The fields are quite under harvest in India. We need everybody's help that can take the gospel to this great, great country. Thank you. I'll be around after services, answer any questions you might have. But thank you so much for the invitation to be with you this morning.